Okay, thank you. So there are different types of live feeds are so far identified: microalgae, rotifers, brine shrimp or artemia, cladocerans, which include Daphnia, Moina, Evadne, Podon. There are different types of organisms which comes under the cladocerans. Copepods, amphipods, last but not least, polychaetes. There are 7 different live feed organisms. Among these, the live feed organisms such as microalgae, rotifer, and artemia are very popular among the aquaculturist or fisheries scientist. Whereas the copepod, amphipods, and polychaetes are it has become popular nowadays. Okay, let us see the advantages of live feeds. Why live feed organisms are important nowadays in the aquaculture? We have a pellet feed, artificial feed we have with us. Then what is the need of live feed? What are the advantages behind the live feed? Okay, the live feeds are able to swim in the water column and are thus constantly available to the larvae. If you use the pellet feed or artificial diet, you can put the pellet feed in your culture tank or culture pond. They can sink or slow sink or float on the surface. Whereas the live feed, since it is living organisms, they can move here and there. They can available in all the places of the pond or tank, so that your cultivable organisms can easily get the live feed. Whereas the pellet feed, they can sink or slow sink or float on the surface. And a very important advantage behind the live feeds are non-polluting one. That is very important. In the aquaculture feed, the water quality management is one of the important criteria. If you are not maintaining the water quality properly, that will affect the entire culture. The unwanted gases, the ammonia and other toxic gases will increase in the system if you use the pellet feed, because the unutilized feed available in the tank or pond, that can be another source of pollutant in your culture system. Whereas the live feed, since it is living organisms, it is available in the system, so that whenever the fish larvae require, they can feed on the live feed. Since it is living organism, they won't create any unwanted pollution issues in the system. And another advantage behind the live feed is the movement pattern of live feeds. The movement pattern and the swimming pattern, they can stimulate the larval feeding responses. And another important advantage with live feed, it has thin exoskeleton. Thin exoskeleton. The shell is very thin and it has high water content. The moisture content of the live feed is very high, so that it is more palatable to the larvae. It is more digestible or more palatable. And the live feeds are supplying all essential nutrition to the fish larvae. The live feeds are providing wide spectrum of size to the fish larvae. That is another advantage. If you take copepod, it has 12 different stages. 6 nauplier, 6 copepodal stages. Especially in marine aquaculture, mariculture, especially marine fishes, their mouth size of the marine fish is smaller than the what we are using nowadays live feed, the rotifer artemia. The size of the rotifer and artemia is larger than the mouth size of the marine fish larvae. Even if we use the pellet feed size is larger than the mouth size of the marine fish. So that the fish is facing a size related issue. Whereas the copepod, it has 12 different stages. Each and every stage, it has their own size range, so that the size related issues will be solved if you use the live feed, especially copepods. And it provides appropriate time. Whenever the fish larvae require, they can eat or they can feed on the live feed, since it is available in the system at all. Whereas the pellet feed, we know the time. Only during time of feeding only we can feed our fish larvae, our shrimp larvae. Whereas this is the live feed is available in the system itself. Whenever the fish larvae require, they can feed on the live feed. And the another important behind the live feed, the movement pattern. It has different pattern. That movement pattern itself, they can trigger the fish larvae to feed over the live feed. So these are the some advantages behind the live feed. Whereas if you use the micro diet, the pellet feed, they are not that much suitable to feed the fish larvae, especially the young ones, juveniles, larvae or fingerlings or fry. Okay. So since the live feeds are having several advantages, each and every hatchery, the fish or shrimp hatchery, even the farm, the shrimp farm or fish farm, there is a need for live feed. Because as I said earlier, live feed is like a foundation. It's a foundation for any culture system. Without live feed, you could not start your aquaculture system. You should be ready with live feed. Then only you can stock your larvae so that the culture will be more successful. Okay. So let us see the microalgae culture. Because microalgae is a primary producer, even the highly carnivorous fish, they can feed initially microalgae. Microalgae is a starter feed for all herbivorous, carnivorous, omnivorous fishes. Okay. So we have a n number of microalgae. So this is a typical a photograph which shows how to maintain the microalgae culture in your culture lab, microalgae culture lab with the different species with by maintaining a hygienic condition, Okay. For culture of microalgae, we have to collect the microalgae from the wild, from the sea, from the open sea or from estuary or mangrove water. Okay. For the collection of microalgae, we need 48 micron mesh plankton net. 48 micron mesh plankton is ideal size for the collection of microalgae. The ideal time for live feed collection, not only microalgae, all live feed collection, early morning. Early morning, that means 4 to 6 or otherwise late evening. If you go to sampling for collection of microalgae or live feed, for early morning and late evening, you can get lot of microalgae and lot of live feed organisms. And once collection is over, the collected microalgae will be transported to the laboratory with the vigorous aeration. Okay. At the laboratory, you have to isolate or identify the species. If you collect the microalgae using the 148 micron mesh, there will be different species of microalgae. We have five groups of microalgae: diatoms, dinoflagellates, green algae, blue-green algae, coccolithophores. Okay. But all microalgae is not cultivable. All microalgae is not cultivable. Only some species are cultivable. So that we can isolate the cultivable species alone. We can identify and isolate the different species by adopting several isolation techniques. And here I have given some example for some common microalgae. This is actually Chlorella. Chlorella marina, we have a marine culture. We need a Chlorella marina, whereas freshwater aquaculture, the Chlorella vulgaris is there. It's a freshwater Chlorella. But this species is ideal to feed the just hatched larvae, whether it is shrimp or fish. So just hatched larvae, to feed the just hatched larvae, Chlorella is a ideal microalgae in size is concerned. Okay. And this is another important diatom. This is a Skeletonema. Skeletonema is one of the ideal microalgae to feed your fish or shrimp larvae naturally. And this is blue-green algae, spirulina, you know well. But blue-green algae not that much ideal feed for to feed fish or shrimp larvae, since it is a filamentous nature. The all blue-green algae is filamentous nature, but some species called picochlorum and some other species, they are in a spherical in shape, but most of the species are filamentous nature, so that the most of the cyanobacteria is not edible for fish or simple larvae. And dinoflagellates, we have dinoflagellates with us. But dinoflagellates is not suitable algae to feed fish or shrimp because dinoflagellates are toxic in nature. They can produce poison or toxin. So the dinoflagellate may not be a suitable microalgae for you feed your larvae. Okay, then last one is, this is coccolithophores. We have isocrysis, which comes under the coccolithophore. So there are different types of microalgae, starting from green algae, blue-green algae, diatoms, dinoflagellates, and coccolithophores. Among these three, five groups, the green algae, that is chlorophyceae, and diatoms, bacillariophyceae, and few species of coccolithophores are ideal feed to feed your larvae. Okay. So after identification, we have to isolate the individual microalgae. For isolation of microalgae, there are different methods are there. One is pipette method. The pipette method is nothing but just using the micro pipette. Okay, you just take one drop of algal samples from the mixed algae sample. You just take that drop of samples in the cavity slide. Under the microscope, you can just sit under the microscope, especially stereo zoom microscope. It, by using the micro pipette, the larger sized microalgae, the larger sized microalgae will be isolated using the micro pipette. It's called pipette method. Okay, simple method. Then agar plating method. How the microbiologist or biotechnologist, they are isolating the microbes. The same techniques also applied for the microalgae isolation. You just take 1.5 gram of agar. That agar will be added with 1 liter of medium, suitable culture medium, that is seawater or fresh water. You can take any water. That is depending on the species. Whether it is freshwater species, you can use fresh water. Seawater species, you can use seawater. So you just 1.5 gram of agar will be added in the 1 liter of culture medium. That agar solution will be sterilized in an autoclave for 15 minutes under 60 kilogram pressure and 100 degree centigrade temperature. After that, the medium will be poured in the sterilized 15 centimeter diaphyte dishes and kept for 24 hours. Okay, just now the agar medium is ready. So from the mixed culture, you can just take the microalgae culture using the inoculum, the microbial loop, inoculum. Okay, with the help of inoculum loop, platinum loop, you can just isolate the microalgae and stick on the agar plate. Okay, you just stick on the agar plate and keep that agar plate with microalgae with for 7 to 8 days for incubation. For incubation at 1000 lux, you have to provide 1000 lux light and the 25 degree centigrade temperature. So if you provide this much temperature and light, after 1 week, you can just take and observe your petiplate closely. There will be some microalgae colony. Okay, from that microalgae colony, you can just pick up a small fragment of colony, microalgae, and transfer to the test tube. From the test tube, you can take into the conical flask or beaker. Okay, so this simple isolation technique using agar medium. Then photoactive movements. Photoactive movements, this particular isolation method applied or adopted for isolation of dinoflagellates. The flagellates, they have a photoactive behavior. Photoactive behavior means if you give light, all available flagellates, they can move close to the light. So they can just scoop near to the light. By the help of micro pipette, you can just gently scoop all accumulated flagellates in one side and you can transfer to the test tube. From the test tube, you can transfer to the conical flask or whatever you need. Okay. And serial dilution technique. This is also is not new technique. This already it is used by the microbiologist or biotechnologist for the isolation of microbes. So the concept behind this technique: take the concentrated sample. From the concentrated sample, you can take 1 ml. That 1 ml will be transferred to the another test tube where the 9 ml of water culture medium is there. Okay. So like that, you can take 10 test tube. So the 10 test tube will be marked in a 10 to the power, different level. That test tube will be taken with 9 ml of culture medium. Okay. So the 9 ml of media will be dispersed into each of 10 test tubes with the sterile 10 ml pipettes in aseptic condition. So tubes will be labeled as 10 to the power of Dinesh. Sir. Point is right. So the you take 10 test tube, the 10 test tubes will be filled with 9 ml of culture medium. Okay, from the first test tube, you can take the 1 ml of culture that will be transferred to the second test tube. From the second test tube, take 1 ml and transfer to the third one. From the third one, you can transfer the 1 ml sample to the fourth one. Like that, you can transfer from the one test tube to another test tube. At the end, generally in 9th and 10th test tube, you can get individual species. That means the mixed sample, the concentrated samples will be diluted with the different medium. So that fine at the last test tubes, especially from 8th to 10th test tube, we can get the individual species. That individual species will be transferred to the petri plate or test tubes or conical flask or beaker for further subculture. So this is called serial dilution technique. Then, so we have different types of isolation method. So among these methods, the serial dilution and agar plating technique is more suitable to isolate the microalgae. Okay. Once isolation is over, that all isolated microalgae will be transferred initially to the test tube. You can see here the picture, the top picture, there is the culture will be maintained in the test tube. Okay, so in the test tube, from the test tube, the culture will be subcultured into the conical flask. From the conical flask, it will be subcultured into the bigger sized beakers or even a tank, or large sized tanks. So this is regarding the microalgae culture. To maintain the microalgae culture continuously without any contamination, you have to maintain the water quality condition very properly. For example, the temperature is very important. To maintain the stock culture, the air conditioned room is highly essential. You have to maintain the thermostatic condition. The temperature for microalgae, to keep the microalgae successfully, okay, so 25 degree centigrade temperature you have to maintain by using the air conditioner. And other water quality conditions, okay. So 12 hours light, 12 hours dark condition should be maintained as like a natural condition. Okay. So the 5000 lux light is highly essential. As you know, when the light is highly essential for the photosynthesis of microalgae. Okay. So we have to provide a suitable light. Normally 5000 lux is ideal to culture the microalgae using the two tube lights, fluorescent lamp. Okay. And 12 hours light, 12 hours dark condition should be maintained. So, and other water quality, see the temperature, it should be between 23 and 25 degrees centigrade. And if it is marine microalgae, you have to maintain the salinity between the 28 and 30 ppt. Okay, if you maintain water quality conditions or environmental condition properly, your algae, you can get algae, the bloom of algae after 10 days. After 10 days, you can get a growth phase. I mean, full of bloom, algal bloom. Okay, microalgae bloom. Actually, in the microalgae, there are different growth phases are there. Growth phases. Lag phase, initial phase, stationary phase, exponential phase, death phase. So, normally the life cycle of the microalgae will be 15 days. At the maximum 15 day, it will reach the death phase. So, the microalgae, the cells are very sensitive and the healthy cells are available during the phase of stationary phase or exponential phase. So during the exponential phase, you have to maintain the subculture. You can take the known volume of sample from that exponential phase and subculture into the fresh medium, into the fresh vessel, fresh medium. And these are some recommended algal culture mediums. It is commercial medium, Michaels medium, Conway's or Walney's medium, TMRL medium, mixed culture medium, Giller's medium or F2 medium. These are the commercially available mediums to culture the microalgae. The medium is nothing but it contains solution A, solution B and solution C. What is solution A? Solution A is nothing but it macronutrients. Macronutrients, potassium nitrate, sodium orthophosphate, EDTA, boric acid, ferric chloride, manganese chloride, distilled water. Actually, you can take this recommended amount of macronutrients this all nutrients will be dissolved in 1 liter of distilled water, okay, to prepare the solution here. This is macronutrients. And these are the trace elements. The trace, to grow the microalgae, trace elements is highly essential. It is solution B, zinc chloride, cobalt chloride, copper sulfate, ammonium molybdate. So this much trace elements will be dissolved in 1 liter of distilled water. It will be considered as a solution B. And solution A is contain macronutrients and micronutrients. And the vitamin solution C is very important to grow the microalgae. So solution C is nothing but vitamin B1, thiamine, vitamin B12, cyanocobalamin. So these both vitamins should be dissolved in 100 ml of distilled water. So this will be considered as a solution C. So now we have solution A, solution B and solution C. Okay, to grow the microalgae in 1 liter of water, whether it is fresh water or sea water, you forgot about that. So solution A, just 1 ml of solution A, okay, and 0.1 in 1 liter of water, 1 liter of water, 1 ml of solution A, 0.1 ml of solution B, and 0.1 ml of solution C will be added in 1 liter of water. And after adding the nutrients, you can just inoculate a 10 ml of microalgae, which is isolated from or which is taken from the stock culture. The stock culture, exponential phase of stock culture. You can inoculate within a week or within 10 days, you can get the a well-grown microalgae. So the subculture will be maintained every week or every 10 days once. Okay. So once stock culture is ready, we should take the stock culture to the outdoor condition to produce the microalgae in mass level, in mass culture level. Okay, because to feed the billions of larvae or millions of larvae, we have to produce a billions of microalgae. Okay, for large scale culture, normally the large scale culture or mass culture will be done in outdoor system in the using the sunlight. Okay, so for example, in 100 liter tank or 1000 liter tank, normally for mass culture, we are using commercial fertilizers like ammonium sulfate, superphosphate, urea. The ratio of 10:1:1. You just get ready the medium. Medium means water. You can just inoculate the nutrients. The nutrients is nothing but commercial fertilizers like ammonium sulfate, superphosphate and urea at the ratio of 10:1:1. Okay. After adding these nutrients, you can give vigorous aeration to mix the nutrients uniformly in all the water. So after that, you can inoculate the 2 liters of microalgae culture inoculum. Culture inoculum, 2 liters will be inoculated in the outdoor culture system. Then within a week, because since it is cultured in the outdoor system, by using the sunlight, the microalgae will grow like anything. So we can get large biomass, a huge biomass to feed our fish or shrimp larvae in the hatchery. So you can see here, I have given you one video, small video, under the microscope, this see the how the microalgae is behave. So this is actually a chlorella. We have different strains or different species, chlorella and nanochloropsis, isochrysis, tetracelmis, dunaliella, skeletonima, ketoceras. This is actually green algae. So this is a chlorella species. And if you look the microalgae under the microscope, you can get this is a shape and size of the microalgae. This is green algae. Okay, so this is actually in our laboratory, in our department, we have a microalgae culture facility. At present, we have nearly 40 species of microalgae, which include both marine and freshwater. So we are maintaining the microalgae in our department to feed our copepod and also to fish or shrimp larvae. Okay, so we have 40 species of microalgae with us. If anybody wants the culture strain, you can write a mail so that we will send the culture. And the next important feed, live feed, is rotifer. As you know, rotifer is one of the bioindicator species. Rotifer is actually, once upon a time, it is considered as a pest. So the rotifers are abundantly grow in wastewater. Wherever wastewater is there, you can find the rotifers. Such a pollution indicator species, but nowadays it is used as a feed in hatchery. It's a very good in nutrition. Okay. See, this is a typical structure of rotifers. So we have a different species: Brachyonas plicatilis, Brachyonas rotundiformis, Brachyonas calciflorus. Okay. So there are different species of rotifers are available. It is ideal. It's a zooplankton. It comes under the zooplankton. It's ideal feed for carnivorous fishes, marine and brackish water, and even freshwater fish. So this is the typical structure of a rotifer. So Brachyonas plicatilis is a common species in used in hatcheries. Okay, this is the typical structure, and you can see this is a line diagram and this is microscopy. So this is actually the cyst of the rotifer. You can see in the base of the animal, in the posterior region, in the abdomen, there is a cyst like, this is a, nothing but is a egg of rotifer. So to collect the rotifer is very simple. As I said earlier, the rotifers are available in stagnant water body. Stagnant water body. It is available in fresh water, brackish water, and marine water. Okay. You just collect these rotifers from any stagnant water body. Okay. Normally, the 50 to 100 micron meter four size mesh is ideal to collect the rotifers. So if you find any stagnant water body, you can take the 50 to 100 micron four size mesh, plankton mesh. You just scoop the water, you can get the lot of rotifers available in the stagnant water body. So once Kashi like that, you can see here in the picture, you can, the ideal time for rotifer collection also is early morning or late evening. By using 50 to 100 micron mesh, you can scoop the water from the water body, the stagnant water body, so that you can get lot of rotifers available. Okay. So once collection is over, this will be taken to the lab, in the laboratory. You have to identify the rotifer for species under the microscope. Especially the stereosome microscope is ideal for identification and isolation of rotifers. Okay. So to culture the rotifer, actually the microalgae is a feed for rotifer. So before starting the rotifer culture, you have to get ready the microalgae culture. That too, the ideal microalgae to grow the rotifer, to culture the rotifer, is chlorella. Since the chlorella is smaller in size, this ideal feed to grow the rotifers. Okay. So you have to get ready the chlorella culture initially. Okay. Once it reaches the maximum density, I mean 1 million cells per 1 ml. If your microalgae culture reaches the density of 1 million cells per ml, 1 ml of water, the culture is ready. Now you can collect the rotifers from the stagnant water body and inoculate. After isolation and identification, the isolated rotifers will be inoculated directly into the microalgae mass culture tank to maintain the mass culture, rotifer mass culture. Okay. And you have to maintain the rotifer stock culture in the separate room. Okay. And you can see here the rotifers, the chlorella density will be increased up to 3 to 4 million cells per ml. It's ideal density to grow the rotifer. So once your microalgae density is reached 3 to 4 million cells in the tank, okay, it is ideal density to culture your rotifers. You can inoculate the rotifers directly into the microalgae culture tank. So the culture will be continued till the density reaches about 50 individual per ml. So by providing suitable water quality and environmental conditions, the rotifers actually, the rotifer reproduction, the method of reproduction is, it has both reproduction, sexual reproduction, asexual reproduction. It has parthenogenesis. It has parthenogenesis so that they can multiply as like microalgae through the asexual reproduction. By sexual reproduction, the male and female rotifers are there, so that if you provide suitable water quality and environmental condition, the male and female will undergo the mating and they can produce the cyst or egg. From the cyst, the young ones will be released. So very simple techniques. You just get ready your algal culture, okay, especially my chlorella culture. Once the chlorella density is reached 3 to 4 million cells per ml, you go to this any stagnant water body, collect the rotifers using the under micron mesh plankton net and taken to the laboratory. At the laboratory, using the microscope, you can identify and isolate the individual rotifers using the micropipette. Okay, and that isolated species, a no number of isolated rotifers will be inoculated directly into the microalgal culture tank. Okay, so during time of inoculation, your microalgae will be very green in color, dark green in color. Okay, After a week, after 1 week or 10 days, the rotifers will become dominant, so that the color of the green color will disappear. You can get brown color. You can get brown color. Once brown color is appeared, that is the indication of rotifer abundance. So all available existing microalgae will be consumed. Now the rotifer become dominant. So this is an indication of rotifer biomass. Once it reached, you can isolate, wash with water, you can feed your fish larvae or shrimp larvae. So the very simple techniques to grow the rotifers, and you can see these are the some photographs. And the water quality condition to maintain for the rotifer culture is temperature should be 30 degrees centigrade, pH should be 9, because this is a rotifers, as I said earlier, it is a they can live in highly polluted water where the pH is where the alkaline pH is there. See, you can see here the pH 9, dissolved oxygen conditions 9 to 10 ml per liter, and ammonia level should be 5 ppm. Okay, so if you maintain this water quality conditions, and your rotifers will develop, okay, and it will reach a recommended level of density. For example, after 7 days, the density of the rotifers will reach 500 and above in 1 ml of water. So if this is the ideal harvestable level, you can harvest your rotifers and you can feed your fish larvae. And there are different types of methods are available for rotifer culture. You can see here batch culture, semi-continuous culture, and feedback culture. Okay, there are different types of culture methods are available in rotifer. The batch culture is nothing but algae under low density will be inoculated with low density of brachionus and harvested once, and the algal cells are consumed. You have your algal culture. You can just directly inoculate the rotifers in your algal culture tank. Once the green coloration disappeared, that means all available algae will be consumed by the rotifers. Rotifer will come dominant, become dominant. So this culture will be harvested and feed your larvae. This is single time. So single time. This is called batch culture. Then semi-continuous culture. Semi-continuous culture is nothing but a certain volume of water is replaced by fresh quantity of water with or without algae. So we have a microalgae. The rotifer will be cultured in the microalgae culture tank. A part of the rotifers will be harvested, a partial harvest, and the remaining available rotifer will be an inoculum for the next culture. So this is called semi-continuous culture. Okay, you can harvest the partial biomass of the rotifer and you can feed your larvae, and the existing remaining rotifer will be an inoculum for the next culture. You can add only sea water or medium, fresh water or brackish water or sea water. You can add only water, filtered water, along with microalgae or without microalgae, because we have already microalgae in the system. Okay, so this will be termed as semi-continuous culture. And feedback culture. Feedback culture is nothing but accumulated particulate matter and feces of the rotifers available in the tanks. It will be decomposed in a separate tank using bacteria. So this is nothing but using probiotic bacteria. You just inoculate the probiotic bacteria in Artemia culture tank. So the available existing waste or fecal matter of the rotifers will be decomposed by the probiotic bacteria. And decomposed material, that is nothing but organic energy, will be converted into inorganic energy like nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus. That nitrogen and phosphorus will be a manure for the existing algae in the rotifer tank. And rotifer continuously can grow by feeding the algae. So this is called feedback culture. You can continuously harvest the rotifer, you can feed your larvae, and the system will be continuously working. This is called feedback culture. So batch culture is single time harvest. Semi-continuous culture is you can harvest the partial rotifers and you can continue by adding the fresh medium water. And feedback culture, it will be continued forever, even for a year. You can keep the rotifer culture by harvesting rotifer, you can use for feeding your larvae. And you can the rotifers will be available in the tank continuously without any problem. Okay. See here, you can the rotifer in the microscope, under microscope, you can see the movements, how the rotifer is feeding the algae, microalgae, just making a friction and collecting all available algae and they can engulf. So this is a feeding mechanism or feeding behavior of the rotifer. So the ideal feed for rotifer culture is microalgae. That too, chlorella is the ideal microalgae. Even of course we can use other alternate medium also, but microalgae is best. Then Artemia, you may be knowing about the Artemia, is a popularly known as brine shrimp. We have Artemia cyst. We are importing Artemia cyst from USA, which is harvested from the salt lake, Great Salt Lake, and after processing, that cyst will be processed and vacuum freeze cyst will be exported to other countries. So in, even though we have a long coastline, still we are importing the Artemia cyst from USA. But now the present cost of the Artemia is just 420 gram of Artemia cyst is 5000 rupees. So Artemia is somewhat is a good feed for shrimp and fish. Still all hatcheries are using the Artemia alone because there is no alternate feed so far developed commercially. Okay. And see here, you can see this is biomass Artemia adult and this is Artemia nauplius. This is Artemia cyst. If you see the Artemia cyst in under microscope, you can get this is the structure of the Artemia cyst under microscope. Okay. So this is the systematic classification of Artemia. Artemia is available in the salt band where the salinity is above 500 ppt. Okay, this so that it is called popularly called brine stream. Okay, so Artemia is ideal feed, but nutrition point of view, Artemia is not a good feed. So that the farmers they are bio enriching the Artemia with commercial emulsifiers and feeding their larvae. So the simple method to collect the Artemia, if you go to salt pan, the salt pan in the corners, okay, there will be a huge biomass, Artemia biomass. You can get in the corners of the salt pan pond. You scoop the Artemia cyst and you can take the Artemia cyst to the your laboratory, and the laboratory you can just observe under the microscope for the cleanliness, okay. And after that, you can just inoculate a known amount of Artemia cyst in the seawater, and you can give vigorous aeration. Okay, if you give vigorous aeration, so within 24 hours, if you provide for the hatching, light is very important, and also the aeration, vigorous aeration, temperature, and light is highly essential to hatch the Artemia cyst. Okay, so that you can successfully come out with the Artemia nauplii. That will be washed with filtered seawater or fresh water, then followed by fresh water, filtered fresh water. Then you can feed your larvae with the Artemia. Artemia is an ideal feed for shrimp and all young ones, fingerlings are fine. Okay, so you can directly inoculate the Artemia cyst for the commercial culture. Okay, the nauplii, a known number of nauplii, for example, 80 to 100 nauplii per liter, you have to inoculate in the pond, directly in the salt pan pond. Okay, so if you provide suitable environmental condition, proper water quality conditions, the Artemia will grow, and that the biomass, see, this is the situation. If you go to the salt pan, in the corners, you can get this orange colored, a red colored a pigmented algae. This is pigment, they may be due to the Dunaliella. Dunaliella is one of the microalgae which is living in salt pan along with Artemia. You just collect the Artemia, just scoop the Artemia cyst from the corners of the salt pan pond. That will be washed and taken to the laboratory. The laboratory you can just put in the seawater, filtered seawater, and if you provide proper aeration, vigorous aeration with the recommended level of light, so the Artemia will hatch out, and you can use the Artemia nauplii to feed your fish or shrimp larvae. So commercially, the Artemia is cultivable. Even in India, the Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, which is comes under the Marine Products Export Development Authority, is one of the nodal aquaculture organization in India, where this Artemia pond is there in Thoothukudi, Tharavikulam, and So in Uppur, in Ramnad district, Uppur, they have two Artemia culture system in Ramnad district, Ramanathapuram and Thoothukudi, where the Artemia will be cultured in large scale. It is available in domestic market, but the production which the RGCA is doing, not that much we mean fulfilling our resources, so that it will be improved. Even the RGCA, they are developing some other alternative techniques to produce the Artemia in large scale level. So see, this is the after even after just collecting the cyst from the salt pan, they are going for some processing, drying the Artemia cyst in open condition. In the open condition, so that our dried cyst will be packed in this the boxes tin. It is available. See, this is a brine shrimp eggs. So OSI brand Artemia cyst. This is imported one. Of course, we have our Indian Artemia cyst. It is available in the RGCA, so that we can purchase from the RGCA also. So this is a situation how to hatching the Artemia cyst. Just 1.5 gram of Artemia cyst should be inoculated in 1 liter of water. 12 hours light and 12 hours dark condition will be provided. Okay, if you provide this much water quality condition, after 24 to 36 hours Artemia will be hatched out. That Artemia napoli. So that Artemia napoli will be harvested. Okay, through the under micron mesh. That harvested napoli will be used as a feed for your fish or shrimp larvae. So this is the ideal condition to culture the Artemia. Temperature should be maintained between 27 and 30 degrees centigrade. pH should be 7.5 to 8.5. Salinity below above 15 ppt. Aeration is also highly important, and light should be at least 1000 lux. So this is Artemia cyst, this Artemia anopoly, this biomass, adult Artemia adult. So see, you can see here a small video clippings about the nauplius. This is nauplius. See, this is egg cap. This is egg caps. Actually, the cyst, empty cyst, just hatched out. Nauplius will be very active. And till today, actually, the total aquaculture industry hatchery depending on the Artemia alone, because the other alternative feed not commercially developed so far. Okay, then this is biomass. You can see the movement of the Artemia biomass. This is our otherwise called a sea monkey. The brine shrimp are otherwise called sea monkey. So this is Artemia biomass. You just collecting this Artemia biomass, you can just grow the biomass, produce the cyst even in our home aquarium. Okay. And next live feed is cladocerans. Cladocerans, which include Daphnia and Moina. Okay. I hope you are hearing my voice. Okay. So the cladocerans is actually the Daphnia, Moina is inhabiting in the freshwater habitat. Okay. So see, this is the typical photographs of Daphnia and Moina, especially for freshwater fish culture, freshwater prawn culture. The Daphnia and Moina is an ideal feed. We can grow the Daphnia and Moina even in our home, in backyard hatchery. It's very simple to grow the cladocerans. Aslak rotifer, this is actually the systematic classification of Daphnia. This is Daphnia magna, one of the common cladocerans, Daphnia in freshwater habitat. Okay. And this is Moina. So the Moina brachiata, Moina. Of course, we have cladocerans in marine ecosystem, that is Evadne and Podon. We have two cladocerans in marine, Evadne and Podon. That is so far not culture technology is developed for marine cladocerans. But of course, we have a very good technology for culture of freshwater cladocerans, Daphnia and Moina. Okay. So to collect the Daphnia and Moina, as like rotifer, you just collect the Daphnia and Moina from the stagnant water body. If you just take 1 liter of water from any stagnant water body, you can get thousands of Daphnia and Moina. Okay. So normally the Daphnia is attract to light, as like Artemia. If you give light, all available daphnia will be accumulate near to the light, so that very simply you can collect. You can go to the sampling for early morning, okay, or otherwise late evening with the halogen lamp. Okay, see here, since the daphnia is light attractant, you can just lantern out over the water. You can buy, just you can give a light using the halogen ball lamp. If you give light, all daphnids will be accumulate near to the light, so that with the help of a scoop net, a plankton mesh net, you can gently scoop out and collect these daphnia, and the collected daphnia will be taken to the lab for the identification. Okay, so as like rotifers, the microalgae will be a good feed to grow the daphnia and moina. Okay, so just you can collect the daphnia from the any stagnant water body by using the zooplankton mesh under micron. Okay, just collected daphnia will be taken to the lab. At the laboratory, you can just identify for the species. After identification, you can get ready the microalgae. As I said earlier, microalgae is a feed for again daphnia and moina, especially the chlorella. Chlorella is an ideal feed for the daphnia culture and moina culture. Okay, and you can get ready with your microalgae culture, and the collected, isolated, and identified daphnia. Okay, will be, you can see here. So isolated, a known number of isolated daphnia will be directly inoculated into the microalgae culture tank. Okay, so by providing light to keep the microalgae culture in the tank, the daphnia will feed over the microalgae and multiply means it will sexually reproduce and multiply their biomass or numbers. Okay, so the ideal feed for daphnia culture is spirulina, chlorella, and even we can use baker's yeast also we can use, and other alternate culture medium like powdered split pea soup mix, wheat flour, soy flour, and dry split peas also we can use, even the wheat flour, even and the soy flours and other organic menus also we can use, but the microalgae will be best. Microalgae will be best as it is a living organism. If you use more organic menu, it will spoil the water quality, so that microalgae will be best. So by providing light with microalgae, the daphnia will grow. So even the same way, you can collect the moina from the stagnant water body, and you can get ready with microalgae culture in your hatchery. Okay, you can collect the moina, identify the moina under the microscope for the species level, and isolate a known number of moina with the help of Stempel pipette or micro pipette. Okay, and the isolated individual species will be directly inoculated into the microalgae culture tank, so that within two weeks you can get a huge number of daphnia and moina in your culture tank that will be washed and given as a feed to your fish or prawn larvae. Okay, here you can see a small video clipping about the daphnia. So daphnia is a very good organism. You can see this is a very good model organism also. Daphnia will be your Cladocerus will be a very good model organism to test you or any compound, any toxic compounds or any drugs. So this is a typical structure of the Cladocerus under the microscope. It has compound eye. So this is antenna. Okay. Then amphipods culture. So amphipod, nowadays amphipods become very popular among the aquaculture industry, hatchery, because amphipods are rich source of protein, especially the pigments, the carotenoids and astaxanthin. But to my knowledge, in India, no amphipod culture is available. I found one thesis, which is in MCC Madras Christian College. She is my junior, one of my junior. So she did her PhD in amphipod culture. I read her thesis. Okay, so the amphipods so far not commercially cultivated in hatchery, not even in the lab. But this is very good ideal feed for shrimp. It's a very good ideal feed for demersal fishes and shrimp. So the cultures to be developed commercially. It's a very good feed, especially that it has a very good astaxanthin. Astaxanthin is very rich in this amphibole. Yeah, Dr. Sheba, actually she is my junior. She did her PhD in Madras Christian College from the Department of Zoology. She worked on the amphipod culture. She developed some amphipod culture, but not commercially so far cultured in India, but is very good ideal live feed. So there are several amphipod species are there. You can collect the amphipod. This is a benthic organisms. Okay, wherever the seagrass is there, seagrass and the what is that, oyster shell. So you can just collect the amphipods from the seagrass bed or the seaweed. And even empty oyster bed, wherever oyster bed is there, and in some muddy shore, wherever mangrove is there, you can get this amphipod abundantly. You just collect the sediment samples and just isolate the amphipods, and even from seagrass debris, even seaweeds, and empty oyster shell, the amphipods are inhabiting. That will be collected and isolated by using a standard isolation method under the microscope, stereo microscope, and this will be cultured in the cylindrical tanks. Actually, the microalgae will be again a good feed for this amphipod. So amphipods available in freshwater all habitats like freshwater, estuary, coastal, intertidal area, mangrove area, and backwater. So the individuals will be isolated from the sediment, or from the oyster bed, or from the seagrass bed. And it will be taken to the laboratory. The laboratory, in the tank, you can grow the amphipods with the help of microalgae. Especially the cylindrical tank is ideal to grow the amphipods. Okay, with the help of filtered fresh water or seawater. And again, Artemia and Opli will be a feed for ideal feed for amphipods along with microalgae. See, for example, the culture tank with the different sizes is suitable, and we have to provide some substratum. Since it is amphipods are benthic organisms, they need some substratum. If you provide some hiding area or some substratum, they used to be hide in that hiding places or substratum, so that the amphipods they can grow well. So the technology, the commercial large-scale technology yet to be developed for amphipod, but this is very good, very ideal feed to feed your shrimp, especially the brooder, shrimp brooder, and also the demersal fishes. Okay, so that you can come out with a good technique. See, this is a very small, this is a video graphs. I downloaded from the Google. You can see, this is actually the substratum, different substratum, which can serve as a very good hiding place for the amphipods to grow. So it will be used, they used to be there in the water column and also the bottom of the tank, in the cylindrical tank. So this is ideal feed for especially the brooders, shrimp brooder or prawn brooder, or even adult fish. Okay, so then polychaete nowadays is become very popular among the aquaculturists. Okay, the reason is polychaetes is a good source of omega-3 fatty acids. It is the polychaetes, the EPA and DHA content is very rich, and also it is rich in pigments, especially the astaxanthin and carotenoid pigments. So that, of course, in ornamental fish culture, in ornamental fish breeding and culture, nowadays the worms and the polychaetes, they become popular live feed. Okay, but the polychaete is not developed so far commercially, especially in India, but some Southeast Asian countries like Taiwan, Japan, China, Vietnam, they have developed the technology for mass propagation of polychaetes. Okay, but now in India, we is yet to start the polychaete culture. So till today, especially ornamental breeder, fish breeder, they are collecting the polychaetes. Not only polychaetes, they are collecting the annelids, earthworms, even bloodworms from the wild. From the wild condition and feeding their fish or shrimp or ornamental fish. But if you use the wild collected polychaetes or any wild collected live feed, it will pave a way for the entry of diseases, since it is collecting from the wild condition where the water quality is very poor. It will be a carrier for the pathogen. So that instead of using the wild collected live feed, if you use the actually produced live feed, it will give good result, especially in terms of growth and pigmentation, especially the pigmentation. Okay, so polychaete culture is also not commercially developed in India, but it's very good feed in especially in China nowadays. The polychaete, there's a great demand for polychaetes, not only for aquaculture purpose, they are also using for human edible purpose. They are just eating the polychaete, since it is a good source of omega 3 fatty acids and pigments. The Chinese are, they are heating the polychaetes for they are preparing for the human food supplement. So along with the aquaculture sector, is a very good source of omega 3 fatty acid. See, this is the typical structure of the polychaete, the one of the species Neris vexillosa. So in a marine ecosystem, there are thousands of polychaete species are reported. Okay, and this is how to collect the polychaetes in the during the low tide time. If we go to the coastal area during low tide time, in intertidal area, the polychaetes are abundantly available wherever the muddy shore is there, wherever the muddy soil. So especially mangrove region, in the mangrove region, and wherever the muddy soil is there, the in that place the polychaetes are available abundantly. Okay, so that you can collect the polychaetes, and you just collect the sediment, and that sediments will be sieved using the different metallic sieves. We have different mesh sized metallic sieves. Okay, so by using that metallic sieves, you can just isolate, segregate the polychaetes, male and female polychaetes, hide it by the species. Okay, and breeding will be done in the hatchery condition, in the captive condition. Okay, by collecting the oocytes. Okay, you can just collect the oocytes. That collected oocytes will be washed through the screen, and retained mucus and parapodial fragments will be discarded. So the parapodial, here this is the place where you can get the sperm from the male and egg from the female. So by cutting the parapodia, you just collect the sperm by cutting the parapodium and write male without allowing the contents with mixed wall. That sperm will be collected, and likewise the eggs will be collected by cutting the parapodia from the female, and the fertilization will be done in outside. So if you provide suitable environmental conditions, and the sperm and the egg will fertilize, and it will release the larvae. Okay, and before that you have to get ready the seabed means the as like natural seabed, because since the polychaetes are benthic organism, they used to burrow in the mud. So that we have to provide the same condition as like a seabed. So we have to mimic the seabed, and you can just inoculate the male and female polychaetes in the seabed, and you can just cut the parapodia from the male to collect the sperm, and the parapodia from the female to collect the egg, and you can allow them to fertilize. Okay, the fertilization will be external, and they can, after fertilization, they will release the, what is that, the larvae. So that larvae will be plankton. Okay, see, this is the larvae. So this larvae, actually the blastula, that what is that, this larvae will be a plankton in mode, plankton mode, once it mature, and they used to be there in the sea bottom, they used to be burrow in the sea bottom. So that to provide a suitable habitat, we have to create these artificial seas. See, this is a simulated beach. Simulated beach is nothing but in the tank where you can culturing the polychaete. The tank bottom should have this facility, this type of compartment. See, here the sediment. Okay, sediment. So the sediment means pebbles, sand, and mud. It has different layers of sediment bed, so that you can just inoculate the polychaete, and you have to provide the aeration by using the aerators through a small tubes and the small tip. That aeration will be given from the bottom of the seabed, bottom of the sand bed. as like bubbles. Okay, so if you provide this simulated beach, if you provide, the polychaete will grow abundantly. The feed again, the microalgae will be a suitable feed to grow the polychaete. So these are some different component of the simulated beach. Okay, so this all sediment matter, sediment will be washed and autoclaved, and autoclaved sediment will be layered in this tank bottom with different layer. I mean sand, pebbles, mud, like that. And you can inoculate the algae as a feed for the polychaete. Okay, see. So once you provide the suitable simulated beach, the polychaete will grow well. They are happily, they will grow and undergoes mating and propagate their generation. Okay, and as I said, the microalgae will be a suitable feed for polychaete to grow. Okay, especially the microalgae such as Dronaliella salina is and Isocrysis galbana. This Dronaliella salina and Isocrysis galbana is a very good microalgae, feed to polychaete to grow. Okay, and we can also use other waste. See, this is the small video clippings about the polychaete. You can see this is actually parapodia. You can see here the thread like. So this is a parapodia, this is intestine. Okay, so nowadays the polychaetes become a very popular life feed, especially the shrimp and fish brooder, since it has more omega 3 content. Okay, if you feed your fish or shrimp brooder with polychaetes, the fish or shrimp, they can produce more eggs, since it supply the more omega 3 fatty acids. Okay, so last but not least, I just explain about the copepods. What is copepod? Because as I am working on copepods for the first over 15 years, so to my knowledge, so copepod is the best live feed. So among the various live feeds like microalgae, even starting from microalgae, rotifer, artemia, cladocerans, amphipods, even polychaetes, so the copepod is best feed to grow the fish or shrimp. So the reason I will explain. So compared to any other live feed, copepods contain more protein, very particularly digestive enzymes. So the digestive enzymes are very rich in copepods, so that if you feed your fish or shrimp larvae with the copepod, your animal will digest the food material as early as possible, so that they used to feed again and again. So within a short period of time, your animal will become more bulky, so that the farmers will get more benefit. The farmers will get more benefit. And copepods are rich in essential amino acids, and is an excellent source of highly unsaturated fatty acids, especially EPA and DHA, eicosapentaenoic acid and docosahexaenoic acid, and arachidonic acid. Actually, as I am working on copepod for the first over 15 years, we have analyzed the biochemical profile, nutritional profile of the copepods. It's showing very good. It's a tremendous source of nutrition, which is highly need of fish or shrimp larvae. Okay, it is rich in EPA content and arachidonic acid, and it is rich in antioxidant. It is rich in astaxanthin. Astaxanthin is very rich in copepods when compared to any other live feed. Okay, and it also contains vitamin C, E, and minerals. All nutrition, essential nutrients of fish larvae required is available plenty in the copepods. So that I am proposing the copepods will be a only alternative. Copepods is a only alternative to increase our aquaculture production. I will show you. Okay. The advantages behind copepods. The advantages as live feed, which is not exist in any other live feeds. Okay. Copepod, actually, the copepods, it has different swimming pattern, movement pattern. Okay. You can see the swimming pattern. These are the some swimming pattern, movement pattern of the copepods. Actually, it has different movement pattern, zigzag movement pattern, short gliding movement pattern, and jerking movement pattern. So this movement pattern itself triggering the or stimulating the fish or shrimp larvae to feed over the copepod. This is one of the advantage in copepod. This advantage you may not get any other live feeds like rotifer, artemia, cladosporin, or polychaetes, or what, even amphipods. So this movement pattern can trigger the fish or shrimp larvae to feed over the copepods. And another advantage with copepod, the size. See, if you take rotifer, there is three types of rotifer: SS type, S type, L type. I mean, large type, small type, super small type. These all types are size-wise larger than the mouse size of the marine fish larvae. They are larger than the marine fish, mouse size of the marine fish larvae. Similarly, artemia. Artemia mouthly size is always larger than the mouse size of the marine fish larvae. Even the amphipod, even the polychaete, you can take any live feed. Whereas the copepod, it provide a wide spectrum of size, broad spectrum of size. The copepod is contained 12 stages, 6 nauplia stage, 6 copepod stages. Each and every stage, it has their own size, so that you can use copepod to feed your fish or shrimp larvae. Okay, you can just inoculate the copepod. The fish larvae, they can select the nauplia 1 or nauplia 5 or copepodite 1 or 2. Based on their mouth size, they can select their prey. So this advantage is available only in copepod. You cannot find any other live feed organisms. Okay, and the other important advantage behind the copepods. This is very important. You can the aquaculture is the people, those who are working on aquaculture. You please note down, the copepods are emitting pheromone. What is pheromone? Okay, so the copepods releasing pheromone. Pheromone means is a hormone, one of the important hormone, which can improve or enhance the reproduction of any cultivable organisms. Okay, so this pheromone is nothing but is a chemical which is released in the water, okay, to attract their pair. So this copepod, actually male copepod, they release the pheromone in the water to attract their female for their copulation, I mean mating. Okay, this particular behavior that emitting pheromone by copepod nowadays become very important in aquaculture sector. Why? Because this pheromone, due to releasing pheromone by copepod, the moment if you give the copepod in your pond or tank, the fish or shrimp, they can identify easily their prey. The prey means copepod, through the smell. They can engulf on the copepod. This advantage is very recently identified. The copepods are releasing pheromones. Okay, and another advantage behind the copepod, some species of copepods are emitting light. So during night time, you can just inoculate the copepods in your pond or in the tank where you are culturing fish or shrimp. Since the copepods are light emitting behavior, your fish or shrimp, they can easily locate the prey, and they can easily engulf. So the copepods, along with nutritional characters, it has other important advantage characters like light emission and pheromone emission and size related. It has broad spectrum of size and it has different movement pattern. These all characters make them copepod as a ideal feed in the aquaculture. You should not replace the copepod, okay? Because that much advantage is there among the copepod. If you use the copepods in your aquaculture, definitely I am sure that you can get lot of benefits, okay? So that with these advantages, actually our team, we have collected the different species of copepods from different places of coastal area, from mangrove waters, from coastal area, riverine region. Okay, so to collect the copepods, we use normally 150 micron mesh plankton net. During early morning, you just go and throw the plankton net, you can get lot of copepods. Actually, copepods are popularly known as insects of the sea because of the abundance. It is abundantly available in the sea. But the moment if you bring the copepod to the lab condition, it won't survive. That is the only difficulty in marine copepod, I mean especially copepod culture. Okay, once collection is over, the collected copepods will be taken to the laboratory. Okay, at the laboratory, we are segregating the copepods based on the size. Based on size means the copepods are their size dependent. Okay, so by using different sieves, superimposed. This is the actually the one of the apparatus which we have developed, fabricated in our department using different mesh sieve. This is called a superimposed sieve. Okay, which have different mesh size. You just pour the collected coffee pod samples just over the 500 micron, and based on the size, the coffee pods will be segregated. Okay, once it's segregated, the segregated samples will be taken to the. See, these are some important coffee pod species. So, so far 12,000 species of coffee pods reported in the world. 12,500 species so far reported. In India, we have reported over 400 species. Okay. So among the coffee pods, actually in the coffee pod, there are 10 suborders are there, coffee pods. So among the 10 suborders, 3 suborders like Kalanoida, Cyclopoida and Antarcticoida. These 3 suborders are free living coffee pods or pelagic coffee pods, which these 3 suborders are only used as a feed to feed your larvae. Whereas the remaining suborder, the animals or coffee pods comes under the remaining 7 suborders or parasitic coffee pods. So parasitic copepods, there is no any aquaculture importance. These 3 suborders like Kalanoids, Cyclopoids and Arpaiticoids, we can grow in the water and we can use to feed your larvae so that we can produce a very good high quality larvae. So after collection is over, after segregation is over, then we used to take that segregated animal to identify under the stereozoom microscope. So based on the key characters provided by the various authors, we can identify the species. And after isolation is over, we are just inoculating in the small test tube. We are maintaining at present in our department, in my lab, we are maintaining 10 species of marine copepods. Even of course, we also doing some freshwater copepod culture. Okay, so this is one species. Nanocalanus minor, you can see in the screen. This is Paracalanus parvus, is a common species, copepods living in a marine ecosystem. This is Pseudodiatomus anandali, okay. And this is Nitocora affinis. See, for example, for your information, I will tell you, this particular species, this is reported very recently in India. Okay, this particular species is ideal feed for shrimp, especially shrimp, because this Nitocora affinis is a benthopelagic copepod. Benthopelagic copepod means they used to be there in the water column and also the bottom of the tank. So this is an ideal feed to feed your shrimp or prawn. Okay, this is actually Tisbe. This is another important Arpacticoid copepod. This is Eutropina. It's a Eutropina acutiprans. It's a Arpacticoid copepod. And this is a Aythona rigida, now renamed as a Di Aythona rigida. This is a comes under the Cyclopoid group. Okay, so to my knowledge, actually I am working on for the first over 15 years. To my knowledge, this particular species is a highly candidate species. This is a very good candidate species in aquaculture is concerned. Okay, so which comes under the Cyclopoid group. Okay, so this is actually culture facility established in our department. Under the financial support of DBT, Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, they have the DBT supporting me a lot to establish the coffee pod culture, because the coffee pod is need of the hour, especially in aquaculture. The coffee pod is going to rule the entire aquaculture sector, because it's a very good feed to produce the good quality of seed. So this coffee pod culture facility established in our marine planktonology and aquaculture lab of our university, under the funding support of DBT. Okay. How to isolate the copepods? We have collected and segregated and identified the species level, and isolation is one of the challenging tasks in copepod is concerned, copepod culture is concerned. So that actually normally how we isolate, no? You just take the segregated or diluted copepod sample in the petri plate, sit under the microscope, especially the stereozoom microscope. Take the micro pipette or stemple pipette with the help of small, fine brush and needle. You can target one individual and you just gently pick up that individual copepod, transfer initially to the test tube. So like that, we have to isolate at least under numbers of individual copepods. which include male and female. Okay, if it is female, no problem. If it is hepatocyte copepod or cyclopide copepod, they can have the egg sac with their abdomen, so that you can just isolate the buried copepod, buried individuals, and transfer to the test tube. Okay, so by isolating the copepods using the Stempel pipette or micro pipette, and also by with the help of fine brush and needles, we can just isolate a known number of individuals. Initially, it will be inoculated in the test tube. From the test tube, it will be transferred to the conical flask, 250 ml or 500 ml conical flask or beakers. From the beakers, we can transfer subculture into the 100 liter of FRB tank or 1000 liter of FRB tank. So very simple procedure, but only thing we need a dedication, we need sincerity, we have to work under the microscope an hour so that we come out with good culture. Okay, so as like other animal life feed like Erotifer, Artemia, Cladoceran or Happypods or Polychaetes, the microalgae is a ideal feed to grow the copepods. Okay, so in our lab, we are maintaining at present nearly over 10 species. Okay, so the microalgae, we are maintaining 40 species. We have validated the microalgae with all our copepods, and we found only few microalgae is ideal feed to grow copepod abundantly. And the, as like other life feed organisms, the water quality is a very important parameter to maintain the good number of copepods in culture system. Okay, see, the temperature should be maintained between 26 and 30 degrees centigrade. If it is marine copepod, the salinity should be maintained between 28 to 32 ppt. The pH should be maintained between 7.5 and 8.5, and 5 to 7.5 ml per liter of oxygen should be supplied. So oxygen is very important, and the microalgae will be a ideal feed to grow the copepods. So in our laboratory, we are using different microalgae species. So for example, Chlorella marina, Donaliella salina, Isochrysis galbana, Nanochlorella sips, Tetraselmis, and other Picocolarum and other diatom species also. So we are growing copepods. This is actually one of the important facility established in our university campus. With the financial support of DBT. Actually, the DBT, they sanctioned nearly 3 projects to me, okay, especially to establish the copepod culture. So this is actually RAS facility, recirculation aquaculture system facility, established to culture the copepod in mass level. Okay, so this system is working well. The system is contain different component, different filters. Okay, different filters like sand filter, bag filter, carbon filter, biofilter and UV filters. So water will be passed through the different series of filters, and from the UV filter, finally the UV filtered or EV treated water will be supplying all the culture tank. Okay, and this is back filter. So this is the entire setup you can see here. So through the series of filters, water will be taken to the reservoir. From the reservoir, the filtered seawater will be supplied to the all culture tanks. And in the center, we have a RCT, recirculation tank, where the all wastewater, that cultured wastewater, not 100% wastewater, a partial percentage of, partial amount of wastewater, which is overflowing through this all wastewater will be collected here. Okay. So here, you see, this is actually RCT tank, recirculation tank, this all culture tank, this is biofilter. Okay, and here we have sand filter, bag filter, UV filter. From the UV filter, the water will be supplied to all the culture tank. Once the water is ready, the copepod will be inoculated in the culture tank. And during culture, the wastewater, a partial percentage of wastewater will overflow here. And the wastewater will be collected in the RCT, recirculation tank. From the recirculation tank, water will be again pumped through the series of filters, sand filter, and finally to the biofilter, from where the biological organism, probiotic bacteria will be maintained. So this probiotic bacteria converting your organic waste. Organic waste is a source of organic waste in copepod culture. It's nothing but the left out microalgae, decomposed microalgae, which is used as a feed to grow the copepod, and copepod fecal matter, fecal waste. This all decomposed by probiotic bacteria and that water from the biofilter water will be again supplied to the all culture tank. So this is the entire setup which we have developed in our university campus to mass culture of Kopi pot. Okay, and this is harvest sieve. Okay, so these are some important component of the RAS tank. This is actually the aerators. The aerators where the cool filtered air will be supplied, and this is air lines. Okay, these tubes will be, antimicrobial. It is free from any contamination. These all equipments or compartments will be used contamination free. Okay, so the cultured coffee pods will be harvested using the different sieves, mechanical sieves. So finally, the harvested coffee pods will be supplied to the fish larvae. And these are the population of the different species of marine coffee pod. See, this is this much population we have got so far, which include Nauplius, Copypodes, and Atel. Okay, this is Sura diatomus. See here, I would like to show you a video. This is a particular one of the species, Pseudo diatomus anandali. Let's see the movement pattern and how the copepods are behave in the culture system. This is the biomass of the zoo, particular species, Pseudo diatomus. So you can find copepod culture only in our university. Nobody is culturing copepods in India. Okay, so that this is actually we have tie up with the other Institute. See here, this is a biomass, Pseudodiatomus, Kopi pod cultured in 5,000 liter and 10,000 liter tank. You can see here the biomass of the Kopi pods. So this much actually we can able to yield. And see the, this is another video evidence, Kopi pod biomass. You can see the, how the Kopi pods population is there in culture system. So due to time constraint, I just skipping this video. And this is a population of the another species. You can see this is Nitocara affinis, which I show tell this is ideal feed for shrimp and prawn. This is Benthopoda. You can see the movement. This look like a worm. This is ideal feed for shrimp and fish brooder. And this is Aitona rigida. You can see the this is ideal. To my knowledge, this is a very ended species. So see, this is the harvested biomass in just one micro appendage tube. So this is a potential species can yield more density. So this is the facility established in our university, the RAS facility. This is some news clippings which published in our local dailies about our culture technology development breakthrough. So first time in India, we have developed the culture technology for Kopi pods, especially for marine Kopi pods. So at present, we have nearly 12 species of marine Kopi pods with us. Okay, so if anybody interest to work on Kopi pods in collaborative mode, in collaboration, even of course, at this juncture, I would like to inform you, there are some institutes like CIBA, CMFRA, even RGCA, we have tie up with the RGCA. And even universities like Satya Bhama University Ocean Research Center, they are showing interest to work with us, especially on this Kopi pod and aquaculture. This particular marine Kopi pod is an ideal feed for especially marine ornamental fishes because it improves the pigments. So due to time constraint, I have not included that validation how Kopi pod is improving the growth and survival pigmentation of the fish. So that I just only touch upon the live feed culture. Okay. And these are some news about the breakthrough. And we have also supplied the Kopi pod to CIBA, CMFRA, RGCA, National Institute of Oceanography. Okay. And farmers also. Some farmers also, especially the ornamental. He is actually one of the farmer in Karur. He came to my department and he taken the Kopi pod and he have given very good feedback. It is improved the pigments in the ornamental fish, especially the clown fish and blue damsel and so on. So with this, let me conclude my talk. So at this juncture, I would like to thank the authorities of Satya Bhama University, including the founder and chancellor and the president and the chancellor, the Vice Chancellor, Registrar, and all authorities, directors, and the HOD of this biotechnology department, and Dr. Masalamani, organizing secretary of this Department of Biotechnology. I should thank Department of Biotechnology because the DBT is they are supporting lot to develop the COPI port, especially the COPI ports, so that they have sanctioned several projects. And I should thank the our DBT and my own university, Bharatdas University, for permitting me to deliver this lecture in this webinar. So the last, I would like to just conclude. Live feed is good. Definitely, the live feed is going to rule the entire aquaculture sector in coming days, because as the pellet feed is polluting the environment, and pellet feed is not that much efficient in yield is concerned. Moreover, feed is the cost of feed is the total production aquaculture production. 60% is going for feed. So if you use the live feed along with pellet feed, so that the farmers will get more benefit. So that very recently one technique called bioflock and copy flock. You just note down bioflock and copy flock. There is one farmer in Thailand who is doing the shrimp culture only with the natural feed. He is not using any pellet feed or artificial diet. Only with the natural feed like copy pot, amphipod, polychaete, and microalgae, he is getting very good yield, and he is giving a. He is stating that he, when compared to pellet feed, he is getting more yield, and moreover the water quality is not spoiled, environment will be conserved. So with this, I let me conclude my talk. So definitely live feed will be a very good one of the important component which is going to rule in the entire aquaculture sector in future. So thank you very much. So once again, I will thank all the authorities of Satyabhama University, very particularly the head of the Department of Biotechnology, and the organizing secretary Dr. Masalamani Selvam, for having given me an opportunity to share my ideas on live feed. So if you are the participants, you are most welcome to raise any questions. If you have any clarification or doubts, you are most welcome. I am happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the elaborate and extensive coverage on live feed. And we have a lot of comments in the chat. Due to time constraint, I'm just giving you a few questions. Maybe the rest of the questions can be directed to your mail ID.
Yes, sir. Yes, sure.
There is one question from a person where he asks whether frozen artemia is good or bad on fishes.
Any frozen is not good, to my knowledge. So live food is always good, because if you frozen, no, there are some nutrients, especially the vitamins and some new important nutrients, they may be denatured. So the frozen is not at all good. The live is always good.
There's another question from Dr. P.R. Tank. How can we avoid contamination during mass culture of microalgae?
So mass culture of microalgae, if you use actually the what is that, you know, we do outdoor culture, mass culture in outdoor, there is contamination. We should not avoid the contamination. We should not avoid. Otherwise, you can go for some greenhouse. If you culture the microalgae in greenhouse system, we can avoid the. In open condition, it is not at all possible to avoid the contamination.
There is another question on how to maintain a pH of 9 in a rotifer cult.
Okay, actually, if you maintain more microalgae, if more microalgae production is there, it increases the pH. There is a positive relation between the microalgae density and pH. Okay, so that as the microalgae is a feed for rotifer, definitely if you maintain more microalgae blooms, microalgae biomass, it will increase the pH. So by maintaining a microalgae biomass, we can maintain the pH. There is no any addition and deletion. We should not add the base and acid in the culture system. By improving the microalgae biomass density, we can maintain the pH. So that is biological system.
There is another question, sir. He says there is in artemia hatching, 24 hours light, is it not necessary? It's a question, sir. They are keeping 24 hours light indoors. And in indoor algal cultures, how many hours light to be maintained and up to what level, they are asking.
Okay. Actually, for microalgae, 12 hours light and 12 hours dark should be maintained. Recommended level. That 5,000 lux light should be provided using two fluorescent tubes. If you use two fluorescent tube lights, that light is equivalent to the 5,000 lux. And another one thing I would like to emphasize here, when the microalgae reach the stationary phase, okay, as I said, there is a different growth phases. So initial phase, lag phase, stationary phase, exponential phase, at last death phase, five phases are there. When the microalgae reach stationary phase, you have to cut down the light. That means from 5,000 lux, you have to provide 2,500 lux. That means one tube light should be switched off. So when they reach stationary phase, not that much light is required for the microalgae. So that 2,500 lux is enough to maintain the microalgae in the exponential phase. But rotifers, Artemia, actually 24 hours light and aeration is essential to hatch the cyst efficiently. For 100% hatching succession, light and aeration is very important. 24 hours you have to give the light to maintain the temperature. The lightation is maintained by temperature. So the light can improve the temperature of the medium so that cyst will be hatched out without any problem.
There is another question wherein they're asking for which live feed is good for ornamental fishes like moli, zebra fishes, angel fishes, etc.
Okay. To my knowledge, especially for ornamental fishes, copepod is the best feed to my knowledge. Because we are validated. I am not just blindly telling this. Okay. We have validated our feed, how far our copepod is best with rotifer, artemia, even microalgae, but now I'm not compared our result with the polychaete and amphipod. Culture is not available and present. But very recently, I have been sanctioned another project. It's a big project by DBT in which we're going to develop the amphipod culture and polychaete culture also. Okay. To my knowledge, the copepod is best live feed in terms of nutrition, especially omega-3 fatty acids and pigments called astaxanthin and beta-carotene, carotenoids. The carotene, I have evidence with me, but since this is live feed, I am not included here. Okay, so we have validated with the copepod with one ornamental fish like clownfish and blue damsel, black damsel. One professor, Dr. Rajit Kumar, who is formerly professor in marine biology, Annamalai University, now he is in NBFGR. I have given copepod to Professor Rajit Kumar. He validated my copepod with his one fish, that is a black damsel. He have given very good report. It is improving tenfold, improving the pigments in copepod fed one compared to artemia. So the copepod is best feed, even not only for ornamental fish, even for edible fish. So we have worked with one fish, Monodactylus argentus. It's an ornamental fish, practice for ornamental fish. The pigments life is like anything in copepod. So copepod is best feed.
Okay. One last question, sir. Whether all copepods in your lab are developed indigenously for and from Indian conditions? I mean, there is any copepod stock culture from other countries, or can we get any copepod stock culture from your lab to start with? That is what one person is asking.
We are not having any exotic species. We are all the species we have developed that are indigenous species. So we are collected the species from different coastal area, and we are maintaining the stock culture, and we have also RAS facility for mass culture. Okay. So we are not importing any copepod culture. We have developed our own indigenous species. So if anybody are interested, you are most welcome to visit our culture facility. We have a very good culture facility.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that wonderful presentation. We have a lot of other comments stating that it is a very excellent presentation, and most of them would like to communicate with you through email, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I guess they can visit the Bharadas University website to get your email ID.
Yes, yes, sir. It is available. So I should thank you and your university, the organizing secretaries and the participants. The participants are large. So for the kind listening, we are most welcome. You are most welcome to visit our facility and our university. Okay, you can get the my email ID from my university. You can contact me through email. I am here to help you in all the ways. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you all the participants. So with this, we are ending today's session. For tomorrow's session, we'll be having Dr. Deepak Samuel, who's a scientist in the Conservation of Coastal and Marine Resources, National Center for Sustainable Coastal Management, Government of India. Thank you, one and all. Thank you for this wonderful. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you once again. Love, freedom.